time to learn our first official law of physics. This is exciting. The first law of physics. We might call it the first and most basic law of nature. No one knows why this law is true, and it took a lot of smart people a long time to realize that it is true. In fact, we now think that it's true everywhere, for all time, and applies to all things. That's an incredibly cocky statement. We might call it the law of stubbornness. Its more formal name is the law of inertia. And even more formally, it's called Newton's first law of motion. For that reason, I'm going to call it N1. N1 is Newton's first law of motion, the law of inertia, the law of stubbornness. Here it comes. If no net force acts on an object, then that object's motion does not change. Said more simply, this law states that objects are stubborn. They tend to keep doing what they were doing before, unless a net force intervenes to change that situation. Uh-oh. N1 involves an expression that is slightly new to us and sounds a little technical. That is net force. All the other expressions in this law seem familiar. Let's dissect this term net force. The meanings of both words, net and force, are important and subtle. Force is a hard thing to define, but we tend to know it when we see it. A force is a push or a pull. Here's a simple device that measures force. It's called a spring scale, a force scale, or a force meter. I'm going to call it a force meter because it measures, that is, it meters force. Notice the units of force inscribed on this scale. Newtons. The internationally agreed upon unit of force is the newton. There are plenty of people who live happy and productive lives without ever hearing of the newton. However, I think I can persuade you that your life will be happier and certainly more productive if you will learn what a newton is. Let's get used to the newton as the unit of force. Notice that it's not much force. One newton is about the force of a breath, a fierce breath, acting on your hand. When you blow hard on your hand, you're exerting about one newton of force on your hand. When you tap your head, you're exerting about one newton of force on your head. Of course, you can tap hard or soft, but we're just trying to get a feel for this unit of force. That's good enough for now. I'm sorry that's so vague, but a force is a mysterious thing, and measuring it is a little mysterious too. Here is 10 newtons of pull again, but here's 10 newtons of push. Notice that the only difference between a pull and a push seems to be my vantage point. I tried to define a force as a push or a pull, but I can't even quite say how these two things differ, far less what they really are. So, one newton of force is about the force of a fierce breath on your hand. Remember that. It'll really help. Notice something else about forces. They act on objects. We just talked about the force on my hand, the force on my head, and here's the force on this meter. Forces act on things. But notice also that my hand, my head, and the force meter don't have force. Forces cannot be had. Nothing has force. My breath doesn't have force. Rather, it applies a force to my hand. And even then, my hand does not have the force. Language is very important here. We've got to use words carefully in describing something so ephemeral and yet so important, so forceful, as force. Objects don't have force, although they can apply a force to another object. When talking about force, get used to the verb to apply and forget the verb to have. Nothing has force, not even a stick of dynamite. Here's something else mysterious about forces. They come into and out of existence from nowhere. A force can act for a short time or for a long time, but when the force stops, it's gone. It came from nowhere and it went nowhere. Force is not a thing in that sense. I'm not sure what it is, but it is not a thing. In this sense, force is more a verb than a noun. The verb apply goes well with force. So does the verb exert. But the verb to have does not. I started this soliloquy on force in order to explain Newton's first law, remember, N1. If no net force acts on an object, then that object's motion does not change. We're trying to understand what net force is. Well, perhaps you're getting a feeling for force, but what about net force? The word net means what you might guess, total. Net force means simply total force. Phew, at least that seems easy. But it's not, because forces add up in an unusual way. When you're dealing with force, 2 plus 2 does not always equal 4. Look, 2 newtons to the left plus 2 newtons to the right gives a net force, a total force, of 0 newtons when they act at the same time. Direction matters whenever we talk about force, so we represent forces with arrows. The fancy way of saying this is that force is a vector quantity, and to learn how to add forces requires that we learn how to add vectors, how to add arrows. For a taproot understanding here in radical physics, your intuition about adding arrows will be enough. If you understand how 2 plus 2 can be 0, sometimes, then you're fine. N1 says if no net force acts on an object, then that object's motion does not change. Let's see if I can make this easier to write. Let's symbolize force with the letter capital F. I'll put an arrow over the F to remind me that direction matters. Force is a vector quantity. And we denote net force by writing that word as a subscript, F sub net. Remember, net just means total force, the sum of all force vectors that act on an object at a given time. So the start of N1 says, if F vector sub net equals 0, that is, if no net force acts on an object. Now, I just want to translate, then motion does not change, into symbols. The symbol for motion here is V vector, velocity. Velocity is just speed with direction. Direction matters for velocity just as it does for force. That is, like force, velocity is a vector quantity. So the word motion is denoted by V vector, velocity. But what about change? How do I symbolize that? If you know just a little bit of math, you have probably seen the Greek letter capital delta, that represents the notion of change. In particular, the delta, that triangle, means difference in. So change in motion is symbolized by delta V vector. And no change in motion means delta V vector equals 0. Finally, we can symbolize Newton's first law of motion. If no net force acts on an object, then that object's motion does not change. If F vector net equals 0, then delta V vector equals 0. Does the symbolic expression of N1 really help? Yes, it really does. First, it gets us used to symbols in physics. Each of us spends years in school learning how to use symbols in math class. Here in physics is where that work really pays off. The symbols, the mathematics, will give physics much of its power to solve problems. But it will also afford a kind of understanding and insight all by itself. Look, N1 says, if F vector net equals 0, then delta V vector equals 0. But nature shows us that every logical rearrangement of this sentence is also true. If delta V vector equals zero, then F vector net equals zero. If delta V vector does not equal zero, then F vector net does not equal zero. But best of all, if F vector net does not equal zero, then delta V vector does not equal zero. That is, if a net force acts on an object, then that object's velocity will change. That's a very cool insight into the universe. It's describing the source of all change. Net force is the source of all change. Of course, we'll explore this version of N1 in much more depth in later radical physics episodes. But congratulations, you've just learned the first law of nature, N1.